straight ahead on Main Street, mixing it up. First, we visit a Warren County agri-tourism business serving up ice cream and live music, all to benefit local charities. Then we'll take a detour to Maplewood Cemetery in Mayfield to experience the strange procession that never moves. And finally, we're spending a day in Monterrey, Kentucky with Gray Zeitz and author Silas House to learn about Larkspur Press and see firsthand how text is transformed into a masterpiece, one letter at a time. Coming right up on Main Street.
Funding for Main Street was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by viewers like you who support quality programs such as Main Street that appear only on public television.
Hello and welcome to Main Street. I'm Barbara Deeb. You know, Kentucky is home to many fascinating people, places, and things. On this edition of Main Street, we have three very different stories that are a combination of them all. So sit back, get ready, because we're mixing it up on Main Street. About some great homemade ice cream with a topping of live music. Well, that's exactly what you'll get at Cheney's Dairy Barn in Warren County, where they serve up some really good homemade ice cream and live musical performances to benefit local charities. Let's take a look now as radio show host Dan Modlin and school psychologist Skip Clevenger serve up some live music with ice cream on top.
This song I wrote for a buddy of mine who's if you listen to NPR, you probably hear him on here. His name's Doug Doyle. He's a news director in Newark, New Jersey. And this is actually based on a true story out of the state of Pennsylvania. It's called The Backroads.
A songwriter's round, this really developed in Nashville. And it's a situation where instead of having a songwriter stand on a stage by themselves and playing for an hour and a half or whatever, a group of songwriters will play at the same time in a semicircle or a full circle. The round comes from, in some settings, you can actually put four chairs facing each other and they just go round and round. And each songwriter plays one song and then the next songwriter plays and it just goes around and around for 2 hours. And you have to have some pretty good stuff to keep up with the competition.
The power of music is the connection to people, and I enjoy being in a variety of situations in which I can play music, but to me, to be able to connect with the audience, and these writers' nights tend to be pretty laid back. There's opportunities to talk, and I think the intimacy of the room, that's what lends that sort of connection between the musicians and the people that are listening to the music. The smaller the room, the you can see people's faces, you can see reactions, you can feel like you're having a conversation as you're describing what you're about to play rather than, you know, this distance that tends to happen between a stage and an audience and so on. So these smaller rooms are better for the kinds of music that I'm used to playing, and I think for Dan as well. You know, he's trying to connect, his songs are trying to connect, and having the crowd, you know, 10 feet away from you, that's it really helps that process along.
But in a singer-songwriter setting, you can see it in the faces. When you look around, you can tell if people are really paying attention, if they really start, some of the lyrics maybe start to have an impact on. And that, to me, is what really keeps me going, is that you see that reaction from people in the crowd. And there's one song I've got, called a dead town, about a town that's been on hard times. And I didn't really write it intending it to be a sad song. It's more just a statement of fact. But I have to tell you, several times I've played that song at the Bluebird and I've seen people with tears. And that wasn't what I intended at all. but I guess the fact that it's touching somebody, that's what you really feed on. I mean, that is so wonderful in a live setting to be able to have that visual contact where you can see that somebody's really paying attention and drawing something from the work you've done.
And we fear for our lives, praying that God will watch over.
Yeah, I think the brain is wired for, you know, for music, and I just think it, you know, it can touch us in ways, it can release memories, it can evoke feelings and emotions, and sometimes strong emotions. And I think we're wired for music, and that's what I really love about it. I love being able to play in situations where it's a service almost for some people. And I think that just, again, just the heart and the soul of the music, that's, you know, that's what it's all about.
A lot of us go into the music business thinking we're going to get a nice financial reward at some point, and most of us are still waiting for that. But I think you come to a point, I certainly have, where you feel like the music is more important than really how much you're going to make out of playing this weekend. And so the people who have been playing these benefit rounds have been doing it just because they want to play. So yeah, we're doing it for free. And it's easier, I have to say, it's easier for us because a lot of us do have day jobs. If you don't have a day job, and a Saturday night means the rent, and I understand that. But it is a nice aspect of this. The people who are doing it because they love the music and they don't mind helping a good cause.
Again, it's fantastic. I've been blessed. I think Dan's been blessed. I think we could all say we've been blessed by these opportunities to play and, you know, fabulous venues or venues that have a long history like the Bluebird. However, you know, when you can take something that a talent or whatever that you've worked on and honed over the years and you're still growing in and so on, when you can take those things and use them for the service of others, you know, again, it puts another layer on the music, an emotional, psychological, sort of heart-filled layer that you just can't put a price on. It's you know, it's just a tremendous thing, a tremendous opportunity. I was really thankful to be there.
I think there's a niche out there someplace for this kind of music played in a place like that. I'm not sure that it takes a particular kind of setting to be successful with songwriter venues. I just think people enjoy the music, and Cheney's is a nice place for families to come, and it's a smoke-free environment. We don't have to play late at night, and it's really kind of ideal.
Maplewood Cemetery in Graves County is home to the famous Wooldridge Monuments. Now, there are a lot of stories that surround this unusual set of 18 markers made out of Italian marble and limestone. Well, we spent a stormy night in the cemetery to find out more about this unusual family tribute and to see if they ever do move.
Well, this is an old cemetery that's been here since the 1800s. And of course, there's a lot of unusual grave sites here that that make good conversations. The Wooldridge Monuments is called the Strange Procession That Never Moves. And all of the monuments were built by a man named Colonel Henry Wooldridge. He moved here when he was about 21 years old. He moved to South Graves County. And when all of his family died, he moved to Mayfield. And that's when he started building these monuments. Each one is to commemorate a family member, his mother, his sisters, his brothers, and two nieces. Also his horse, his dog, a deer. The interesting thing about some of the monuments is the monument of Colonel Wooldridge standing at the lectern was carved in Italy of Italian marble. And the top of his crypt was Italian marble also. The rest of the monuments were carved in Paducah and some in Mayfield. The one of Henry Wooldridge on his horse, and his horse's name was Fop, was brought to Mayfield by a railway car. And as the car was coming to Mayfield, the town drunk got behind Colonel Wooldridge and rode to town in style. As one of the nieces said to him, "Uncle Henry, instead of spending all your money and time on those monuments, you ought to be worrying about where your soul's going when you die." And he said, "Well, I don't know where my soul's going, but my body's going to the cemetery." An odd thing that, at least I think it's odd, is there's no statue of his father. His father died before they moved to Graves County, but it's kind of odd that every member of his family, and including his animals, were memorialized, but not his father. In 2009, we had a nice storm, and a big tree fell on those monuments. And none of the women's monuments were damaged, but they knocked off the colonel's head on two of them and injured the animals and sold, and it was rebuilt. And about 2 years ago, it was finished. Another interesting monument is the Angel Rock. And the angel is standing there, and she is holding a bunch of grapes. And over the years, all the grapes but one have fallen. And legend has it that whenever that last grape falls, the world's going to come to an end. Well, her husband was shot by his deputy, and she was appointed sheriff in his place, and then she was elected sheriff. And so that's an unusual, especially in those days, for a woman to be elected any kind of office. But legend has it that at night, her husband is going all through the cemetery trying to find the man who murdered him. But he never finds him. We have one grave where 11 people are buried in the same casket in a place called Hickory Grove, which is north of here. People were at a dance and they went out to get a breath of fresh air and they saw a glow in the sky. And they knew a house was on fire. And the time they got there, not one person was alive in that house. Well, they couldn't get anybody to get the ashes up to bury them. So they hired a man. He came and shoveled the ashes in a wooden coffin and they were buried here. There's a lot of ghost stories about the cemetery, and there's things people are interested in. You just can't ever tell when Henry Wooldridge is going to be riding his horse up and down these little streets. It might be a little spooky. I wouldn't come out here tonight. Would you?
What began with a small press and a drawer full of type nearly 40 years ago remains a passion for Gray Zeitz, who with painstaking precision keeps alive the art of letterpress printing from a remote workshop in Monterrey, Kentucky, a place where there's no such thing as a deadline, especially not when you're making one-of-a-kind collectible books. Nestled amongst the wildflowers and trees in a remote area of Kentucky known as Monterrey, just north of the state capital, Frankfort, a strange union is taking place, a marriage between letters, words, paper, and art. With the repetitive rhythm of a clamshell press as his musical score, the man they call Kentucky's Gutenberg painstakingly transforms letters into words, words into pages, and pages into books. One-of-a-kind books, hand-pressed, hand-bound, collectible editions.
There are some things that we do that Gutenberg did in terms of setting type by hand. And the way of making books, you know, all the way down. There are some developments that we, you know, the press is a lot more modern. 1916 is a long way from Gutenberg. Started Larkspur Press in 1974, set up in Monterrey, Kentucky. At that time, I had been apprenticing at the King Library Press at the University of Kentucky with Carolyn Hommer. I apprenticed for a couple of years. And at that time, there were some artists and craftsmen moving to Monterrey. A friend of mine suggested that I move here too. And my teacher, Carolyn Hommer, gave me a small press and a drawer of type. And that's how Larkspur Press was started. We're publishers and printers and binders. It's a letterpress shop. We basically make books by hand, primarily publishing Kentucky authors.
Well, several years ago, Larkspur had done a broadside, a little excerpt from my novel, A Cold Tattoo, and it was just this incredible piece of art, and I loved that so much. It's one of my favorite things that's been done from my books. And so I published this little short story, Recruiters, in a small literary journal, and I just really wanted it to have a broader audience. It's one of my favorite, it's probably my favorite short story that I've done. I'm not a real confident short story writer, and I really wanted to try to get it out to more people, and so I sent it to Gray, and he liked it. Thought it was a story that he wanted to publish. It seems like, this will probably sound strange, but it seems like a living thing to me, this kind of book, because, I don't know, there's a coolness to the paper and a sensuality about it. You can feel it, and it's like you can run your fingers over the sentences and feel the words. And I mean, I don't know, maybe it's because I'm a writer, but I think that all readers are aware of that too. And I think that the love and the care that's put into the book during that long process at a press like this, it comes through, and you can feel it when you read the book, when you run your hand over the book. I think that there's a real thin line between the reader and the writer and the maker of the book. It's just a whole different thing than a book that's, you know, just run off in some factory somewhere. And the reader is aware of that, and they're aware of the art.
With Silas's book, these are pen and ink drawings that we had photo engravings made. That's going to turn the artwork into metal. And it's done with a negative that's burned into a light-sensitive metal and then eaten away with acid and then mounted on a block of wood to make it type high. The other kind of illustrations that we use is with wood engravings. I get together with an illustrator, and we may at some point when we get freed up start setting the type, getting a design for the book. The illustrator's working on that end of it, and it sort of just comes together at that point. Now, when it's actually set and the drawings are finished, then that book is priority. And now, at that point, things can stop, you know. Not that it has with this book, but sometimes the author says, I would like to add this, or wait, I'd like to change that. And I wait. You know, we have no deadlines. We print mainly with the Chandler and Price press, which is a clamshell press. It's called a clamshell. You'll see it work, and it just opens and closes like a clam. I don't have the system on there that would automatically add ink to the press. I do something which you call slip sheeting. I'll put a sheet in between each printed page so that the type, the ink won't offset onto the back of the next page, and stack them in groups of 100. Those will dry as long as I can let them dry, at least 2 days. I try to let them dry a week. I'll pull a proof on the press, and then I'll proof it. And if there's some corrections I find, I'll make those right then and proof again. And we just mark those, and then that goes to the author. Then the book is printed, the illustrations are printed separately, any color is printed separately. The book then goes upstairs and gets folded and collated. And then the sewing process begins. And after the books are sewn, and we hand sew, the books come downstairs again, and I trim them. And then they go back upstairs, and the binding process starts. You know, if it's a hardbound, a backing strip is pasted on the spine, and cases are made, and books get cased in. And I try to work as close as I can with the author and with the illustrator, with everyone involved. I mean, you've got to be open with each other. You've got to know exactly what's going on. You just do. And if there's a misunderstanding, you know, I don't have written contracts. If there's a misunderstanding, you make it right. You don't, you know, it's just a way of doing business that's friendly. I mean, I don't have this ideal book to, you know, that I'm looking for. I think the best book I've done is the last book I've done.
And while the story of Larkspur Press is the story about a most unique man with a most unique passion, it's also the story of how a song inspired a short story that inspired a book that became art. Travel with us now as author Silas House chronicles for us the genesis of a short story.
Well, the story was inspired by an incredible song written by Sue Masick. And the song is about 3 minutes long. And it's told from the point of view of a woman whose daughter has gone off to fight in Iraq. And it's sort of mysterious what has happened to her in Iraq, but she has come back and she's been put into a hospital that is nasty. And the song is sort of, it's really complex.
Recruiters come round to our small mountain towns with money and glory to tempt them.
I'd braced for my sons to be one of the ones to follow freedom's anthem, but I'd never dreamed in my darkest of dreams that they'd enlist my Brennan. So on one hand, the song is an anti-war song, and on the other hand, it's criticizing the very people who, you know, claim to be such quote-unquote patriots. That one, you know, real narrow definition of patriotism. There was just so much going on in those 3 minutes. The song is so complex and so packed with, first of all, two really vivid characters. I just think it's phenomenal the way that Sue managed to make this whole world bloom in this 3 minute song. And I just kept thinking and thinking about it, and the characters kept coming to me, and you know, sometimes that just happens and you don't know why. And I knew that I wanted to write a short story about it, and I really needed to write that story.
But my Brennan always knowed who she was, and I guess I'm the only person living in this world who understood her. I knowed from the time she was real little that she was different. She used to rock so hard in that old red rocking chair on the front porch that it leaned all the way back, so close to tipping over that it scared me to death. But she just laughed that big laugh of hers. She wasn't scared of anything, buddy. Brennan always was a tomboy, tearing right along with her brothers, climbing mountains and trees, getting into fist fights, and ending up the winner against boys twice her age.
Ultimately, it's a story about the relationship between a mother and a daughter, and how far the mother will go for this daughter, how much she loves her.
Well, our journey has come to an end, but don't let it stop there. We welcome any questions, comments, or story ideas. Write to us at Main Street, care of WKYU PBS, 1906 College Heights Boulevard, number 11034, Bowling Green, Kentucky, 42101. Or call us at 270-745-2400 or 1-800-599-2424. Check out our webpage at the address on your screen and follow us on Facebook and Twitter. We hope you've enjoyed this look at the interesting people, places, and things that make our Commonwealth so unique. Until next time, I'm Barbara Deeb. Thanks for joining us. And remember, we're just around the corner on Main Street.